In the year 1517, convinced that indulgences were a symptom of a profoundly corrupt church, a young priest in Germany dared to protest. His name was Martin Luther. The reform he led would split the church into Catholics and Protestants, in the process creating a new legion of apocalyptic thinkers.
Luther set out to reform the church, to bring it back to what he saw as its proper mooring. The church, as the institutional church, saw him instead as a great threat to their income and a heretic. Luther would have just been one more reformer in a small area if it had not been for the printing press. Thanks to the printing press, Martin Luther became the best seller throughout the empire.
Luther produced a series of pamphlets which identified the Antichrist as the Pope himself.
The Catholic Church, in effect, put out an arrest warrant on Luther, and so a number of his supporters arranged to have him kidnapped and carted off to the Wartburg Castle. There he was disguised as a knight. He grew a big beard, he gained weight, and he sat down and wrote his famous translation of the New Testament.
Luther's decision to translate the Bible into German is to make it accessible to the people. The Bible will no longer be a mysterious text that is simply interpreted through the medium of a priesthood, but each individual will become his or her own priest.
But when he got to Revelation, Luther had mixed feelings.
He actually says, "My spirit can't penetrate this book. He can't make a good sense of it." Also, he thinks it's really not a central part of the Bible. He actually, in his German translation, relegates it to an appendix.
But what's interesting, even though he felt that way, it's the one book that he illustrated, where he put woodcuts, because Revelation allowed him to make one of his central points, which was the papacy was the Antichrist, and the end of the world was coming. And so there you see the only woodcuts in the New Testament. You see the whore of Babylon wearing a papal crown. You see the seven-headed beast wearing a papal crown. The message was clear. You didn't have to read the papacy. The papal church was where Satan was working to undermine Christendom. And the fact that Satan was there meant the world was coming to an end.
Without meaning to, Luther had opened the floodgates to new interpretations of the book of Revelation.
Martin Luther believed that everyone would read the scripture the same way he did. And so all he had to do was make it available and people would come to the same opinion. Or if they didn't, Satan was subverting them. What he found out was that Satan was very busy because everyone who picked up the Bible and read it were going off in different directions and reaching conclusions that Luther not only disagreed with, but were convinced were the result of Satan's direct.
Thomas Muntzer is an example of what can happen when apocalyptic scriptures become widely accessible. Muntzer took the images of the apocalypse, the images of a desperate struggle between the forces of righteousness and the forces of evil, and applied it to the peasantry of Europe. And he preached to the peasants that the wealthy people of the day are in fact the evil ones whose destruction is foretold in the book of Revelation.
Die Zeit der Ernte ist da.
The time of harvest is here, Muntzer declared.
Ich habe meine
and God himself sent me to his harvest.
Denn meine
I sharpened my sickle because my thoughts are focused on the truth.
It's not a moral reform. It's not a spiritual reform. It's economic. He's worried about the poor. And the working classes, especially in the growing cities of that time, were particularly drawn to his message. This was going to be a class revolution.
On the site where Muntzer would lead his apocalyptic revolution, there now stands a monument to his effort.
Muntzer and a hand-picked army of 300 men go off to the town of Frankenhausen to join the peasants revolt. The princes aren't going to sit around and take this. In fact, they send an army under Philip of Hesse to put down the revolt. Philip places an array of cannons on a hilltop overlooking the peasant stronghold.
The peasants are arrayed against the German princes and their army, and Thomas Muntzer continues to assure them, even at the last moment, that Christ will intervene on their side.
Muntzer steps forward and says, "I will catch their cannonballs in my sleeves and throw them back at them." And just at that moment, a rainbow appeared in the sky.
The peasants are singing, "Come Holy Spirit," believing this battle is the final battle of Armageddon and that God was going to break in and stop it right there.
At least 5,000 of the peasants were slaughtered in that day. Philip's army lost maybe a dozen. It was a horrendous defeat for the peasants' revolt. Muntzer himself was found hiding in a cellar in the town of Frankenhausen and eventually was caught, forced to confess his sins, and was beheaded by the princes. Despite this horrible defeat that they faced, Muntzer's legacy is not one that disappears so easily. Later generations, particularly in Germany, would look at him as a hero, as a proletarian rebel. Marxism would come along later and think of him as a saint, as a martyr to the cause.
This East German monument remains testimony to the enduring legacy of Thomas Muntzer. 300 years later, Karl Marx would transform the apocalyptic ideas of Muntzer into a secular ideology.
The godless communism of Karl Marx has a number of apocalyptic overtones. It relies on interpretations and language from the Book of Revelation in order to understand what's happening in human history.
It envisions history in terms of a series of great stages, which will culminate in a moment of crisis, leading essentially to a kind of millennium, the era of communism, when class differences and exploitation and suffering will end.
We have the words of the Internationale, the communist anthem: "This is our last and final struggle. And after then, there would be no more struggles. All would be peace."